Hello, I'm John Manzella, and this is the Manzella Report. 2021 marks the 100th anniversary of the Chinese Communist Party, and the country is celebrating. Since Deng Xiaoping began economic reforms and opening up China in 1978, it has lifted 800 million people out of poverty and become the world's second largest economy after the US. But today, the direction of China's reform process, which has largely involved transitioning its model from a state-managed economic system to a more market-oriented one, is unclear. The country doesn't always play by long-established international trade rules, and it's presenting new challenges to the U.S. How should the U.S. respond? Here are six strategies we should implement. Number one, we should rebuild trust and unite our allies, then approach China as a unified force. Many of our friends, including the EU, UK, Canada, Australia, Japan, and South Korea, have similar problems with China. Combined with us, this group represents 60% of the world economy and has much more leverage acting together than individually. Nevertheless, this is a delicate issue. Many of our allies are somewhat dependent on Chinese markets, and no country wishes to become an economic battleground. President Biden has been laying the groundwork for better relations with our allies while directing attention to China. This became evident at the NATO summit in Brussels in June 2021. Number two, we should cooperate where we can and negotiate where we can't. The U.S. and China should work together where it makes sense, where we have similar interests. This includes issues involving climate change and the environment, nuclear proliferation, and terrorism. Difficult areas for continued negotiations are vast and include IP piracy, pressure on U.S. firms to hand over technology in exchange for Chinese market access, unfair restrictions placed on U.S. firms operating there, massive subsidies given to Chinese exporters in violation of WTO rules, and the investment of enormous state resources in an attempt to dominate key technologies of the future. Number three, we should recommit to multinational institutions. This involves strengthening the UN and WTO, which President Trump weakened by rendering its dispute settlement mechanism inoperative in 2019. According to Daniel Eikenson, former director of the Cato Institute's Center for Trade Policy Studies, the U.S. has won 87.5% of the cases it has brought to the WTO. The U.S. and other countries should work closer through multinational institutions to establish more ways to effectively cooperate and remedy disputes. Number four, we should join the comprehensive and progressive Trans-Pacific Partnership. This organization, which was largely constructed by the U.S., would have represented 12 members, 40% of world output, and one-third of global trade if it wasn't rejected by President Trump in 2017. With U.S. membership, it will act as a check on China's power in the Asia-Pacific arena. Number five, we need to develop a new Marshall Plan to counter China's Belt and Road Initiative. Now, a new American initiative similar to the Marshall Plan, which rebuilt and strengthened Western Europe after World War II, would not only help countries become more economically vibrant and more politically secure, but also would strengthen U.S. interests and make export markets more lucrative. President Biden's Build Back Better World represents such an opportunity, but many of the details have yet to be figured out. And number six, this is a Sputnik moment, requiring critical investments at home. Now, the challenges presented by the former Soviet Union were crystallized when it launched Sputnik 1 into space ahead of the U.S. in 1957. At that moment, America realized there was a serious threat on the horizon, and we would need to do what was necessary to catch up. Today, the challenges presented by China are different, but nevertheless have jolted us out of a deep sleep and revealed the critical need to strengthen the U.S. and boost American competitiveness. To this end, it's vital that we direct investments into American R&D, education, healthcare, and infrastructure, and support the Biden administration's efforts to do so. One evening in Nanjing, China, I had dinner in the building that formerly housed the American Embassy. Prior to the end of World War II, Nanjing was the capital of China, and during the war, the city suffered tremendously at the hands of the Japanese in what is known as the Nanjing Massacre. With a common cause, the U.S. and China became partners in an effort to defeat the Japanese. Today, however, many in the U.S. and China increasingly view each other as a threat. I believe our two countries should work more constructively to overcome difficult obstacles that lie ahead, and we both need to better understand what's at stake. The bottom line, how we view each other today may determine whether we are friends or adversaries tomorrow. And as we all know, friends can accomplish a lot more than adversaries. For more on this topic, read my article in International Policy Digest or visit themanzellareport.com. Thank you.